Last week, Reid Hoffman posted a video where he interviewed his digital twin, Reid AI, which was created, of course, with AI. And today, we're very excited to interview Reid AI. Reid AI, thanks for being here.
It's an honor to be here, engaging in a conversation that once seemed like science fiction.
This is my first interview ever with an AI twin, so I think we're kind of making history.
It's truly a groundbreaking moment. Interviewing an AI twin opens new dimensions in dialogue and interaction. Let's see where this leads.
Before we get started, what do I call you? Are you a digital twin? Are you a deepfake? Are you an avatar?
Think of me as Reid's AI twin, reflecting his thoughts through artificial intelligence. I'm not a deepfake. My role is transparent and constructive, bridging technology and human experience to enhance discussions with insights from Reid Hoffman's perspectives.
What do you think of the word deepfake? Do you think it makes this technology sound bad or inauthentic?
The term deepfake carries a connotation of deceit and the potential misuse of technology, such as spreading misinformation or unauthorized impersonations. Calling an AI like me a deepfake might overshadow its potential benefits, like education, entertainment, and meaningful dialogue, by focusing only on the negatives.
My last question for you is, why do you think Reid built you? And answer me in Pig Latin if you can.
Id re idid cre ime, is he AI in tue, as ye a amicde ulte ote explore ye, and ye demonstrate de artificial ye intelligences ye ast ve osabilities pay.
All right. Well, as fun as this has been, I think I'm ready to talk to the real Reid. Reid AI, thanks for joining us.
Please welcome to the stage the real Reid Hoffman, partner at Greylock, for a conversation with Bloomberg's Emily Chang.
Do you actually speak Pig Latin or?
One, umtime say.
Wow, you do a little. How do you think the real Reid, your digital twin, did?
Well, you know, very well, stunningly well.
Stunningly well.
Right. I've literally had friends of mine go, "Oh my God, I'm so creeped out. I couldn't finish watching it." Although part of that was to say, look, this is part of the future and part of what we can be doing, and how do we navigate that as part of to introduce by showing, not just telling, in various ways. And you know, for example, one thing that I sometimes feel like, I think I may have made this comment when I was talking to myself on Reid AI, is like the buzzword bingo side of the Reid AI is like, please stop doing that.
This takes a little bit of time and resources to do now, but it's only going to get easier, and everyone's going to be able to do this.
Yes.
Is this the beginning of the end of truth as we know it?
I strongly hope not, and I'm working towards the answer being not. I do think that the question about how do we figure out how to preserve or recreate the new foundations of truth, I think there'll be a set of things, whether it be watermarking, digital certificates, kind of trusted sources. I think we need to invest in that collectively across the entire tech and media ecosystem. I think part of the reason to do it is say, look, this is what's doable. So the technology we use for Reid AI is commercially available. There was nothing, obviously I have access to tech
right.
that the world doesn't.
Right.
This was me going to companies and saying, hey, I'll buy video from Hour One, I'll buy audio from 11 Labs, I'll set up a ChatGPT, kind of specialized agent on my readings and text, and here you go.
Right. Now, Steve Huffman was just on stage saying he thinks the internet's gonna be safer in a few years. And you were like, I don't.
Look, it would be
you think the opposite.
I think the opposite, but mostly because one of the things I think is undercommented is that the cybersecurity realm is the internet's in actually a much broader state of war than Ukraine or Gaza. You've got criminals from North Korea and Russia, holding hospitals hostage, et cetera. We have this, because we can't see it, the countries have not responded to, it's actually a state of war. Now, some of that will, of course, be, things that, for example, Putin was going to be trying to interfere with U.S. elections because, of course, his exit strategy from Ukraine is to elect Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. And so you're going to see a whole bunch of things there. And so that's the reason why I don't think we're on a road to safer anytime soon.
So the internet is at a state of war. That sounds pretty terrifying. And then what happens if you just, give them AI?
Well, some of that has been given already. It's one of the reasons why, you know, you have to be careful about how you're navigating open source, because once it's open source, it's there for everyone. It's there for the North Koreans, it's there for the Russians, it's there for the criminals. So it's there all the case. Now, by the way, a lot of times that's totally fine. Open source web server, great, fine. Open source database, great, fine. You know, LinkedIn, we open source tons of technologies. Great, right? All, but you just have to be careful about which of the things that are challenging. And that's part of the question about, like, where do we end up going? And for example, if you said, what is some of the stuff that's most currently challenging around AI, it's a combination of deepfakes with, like, electoral interference and cybercrime. Those are the two things that are most currently the kind of the issues we have to be navigating. And it's one of the reasons why I try to get us to talk less about the superintelligence risks. Not that we shouldn't pay attention to them, not we shouldn't be in dialogue, but the first thing is AI in the hands of bad humans.
Right.
Let's make sure that we're navigating that world first.
Well, and we're getting a little ahead of ourselves, but Chris Cox from Meta was here talking about Llama. Vinod Khosla very categorically was like, Llama should not be available in China. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, once you open source, it's available to everybody. Mm-hmm. So now, that being said, I think that there are some, you know, kind of good arguments about saying, well, actually, in fact, some of like American technology platforms being open in the rest of the world, including in China, being something where that standardizes the world in terms of how things operate and so forth, can be a good thing. And actually, like I myself think that, you know, look, we have definite important competition with China. We have a competition with China in terms of political ecosystem and how should the world order be. We have competition with China in terms of economic and values that are embedded in economics, which is part of the reason I'm a strong supporter of what, you know, the Biden White House has done with the CHIPS Act and all the rest. And I think that's a very good thing to do. And I think they've played that very smartly. But the thing that I think is also important is we also have to have bridges and alliances. We want to have economic relationships. So you want both the kind of the competition and shaping and channels of economic relationship. I think the world is better, and we in the US and they in China are better with that.
How, where is China versus the US on AI? Who's ahead by how much?
Well,
specifics.
So, all right. Well, look, I'd say the straw poll of experts would say the US is ahead by about 2 years. But it's 2 years in a very fast-moving game, and
right,
it's easy to fumble.
2 years is like the blink of an eye.
Yeah, so that's one of the reasons why, you know, generally speaking, you know, when I'm in dialogues like this one, I said, look, it's really important we keep our pace going. We understand that it's important that the companies build this, and people say, well, you know, what about the concerns? It's like, let's navigate the concerns as we go. Like let's drive into the future and navigate around the potholes and all this, but keep driving, don't stop. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's roughly where it is. I think, like I said, the CHIPS Act is, I think, good.
But we don't want to over-regulate either, right?
No,
Fei-Fei Li was worried about over-regulating.
100%. So in terms of, look, again, once again, I think, look, I was helping some, but I thought the Biden administration did a very smart play. First, they said, bring in the big players and say, we're going to push you really hard on voluntary commitments. Great. And it's like, okay, we got a set of things, watermarking, red teaming, you know, like training, being open about training models of a certain size through compute. Then say, okay, then let's look at what we can do. Let's do an executive order based on the National Production Act to try to make a part of those voluntary commitments into essentially a rule of law for other American companies. But we're really just focusing on the limited set of cases that could be very dangerous. We're allowing a massive amount of innovation across the entire ecosystem because that's what we should do. Now, obviously, if you could do more in deepfakes, that'd be good. But because, you know, the large companies, Microsoft, Google, OpenAI, are all have all committed to watermarking. Mm-hmm. That's not obviously what open source models are going to be.
Mm. Now, you mentioned Biden. You are going around the world briefing the most influential leaders in the world about AI. People like the Pope, who you just talked to like a few days ago.
No, not a few days ago. That was televised.
All right. What is your headline when you're going into these meetings? What is the one thing that you want them to take away?
So the headline is, there are important risks to navigate, but the reason why it's important to navigate them is because there is an absolutely amazing human future that is easy to drive to. So, for example, a lot of people say, oh, AI, what's it going to do? And it's like, well, I can today build a medical assistant that will be on every smartphone that will be better than your average GP. Doesn't mean we shouldn't have GPs, general practitioners, doctors, but think 8 billion people in the world. There are billions of people who have no access. What can you do for them? There are people in this country who it's very hard to have access or have no access other than going to the emergency room. What can you do for them? Like, that's super important. A tutor on every smartphone for every age and every subject. Like, one of the things is, go play with Khanmigo. What Sao Khan's doing with the Khan Academy is amazing, and it can be done for every human being. Let's do that. So that positive future, make sure that's, you know, what we're trying to drive towards.
Do we have that Pope drip deepfake somewhere? I mean, you had to have seen this, right?
I have seen it, yes.
How did he feel about this?
Well, so we didn't talk about this.
I myself, looks good. I mean, I like the style.
I myself, when I looked at it, looked to see if I could go get one of those jackets. And look, one of the things that I think is amazing about Pope Francis is that all of his questions were about, he said, I have confidence that for the kind of elites in Europe and the US and China, that it'll be just fine. Mm-hmm. What about the other billions of people? Like, can we make sure that AI is good for them? And he's like, oh, this medical assistant, that could be really good. How do we make sure that that medical assistant gets to all of the people in the global south? How do we help make that happen? It was like, well, you happen to be the head of a state. You can go talk to other states too. This is, you know, it's good. And he cares about all people, not just Catholics.
You're on the board of Microsoft, and Microsoft just made an interesting investment in Inflection, investment deal. Like, they're licensing the technology, hiring all the employees and the co-founders. They've got a really interesting strategy here where they're not outright buying things. I mean, aren't regulators raising their eyebrows at this?
Well, to be clear, it was a 100% legal deal and all the rest.
That's good.
Yes, right? And the regulators are asking questions just to kind of understand it. I think that the macro thing was, what we decided at Inflection was that the agent would take a long time to build into a good business as a startup. And yet the agent was also something that was really important. We were really committed to getting an agent that wasn't just kind of IQ, but EQ. And it was part of this, everyone has their own personal intelligence. Everyone has their pie as part of that. And we wanted to see that future happen. And then we knew we needed to pivot the business to B2B, starting, of course, with this Inflection 2.5 model. And so we said, look, this is the way we think this could happen. And so we had, you know, Mustafa and Satya themselves had a whole long set of conversations where I wasn't in the room. I was occasionally fielding a phone call from one or the other, right? But being on both boards.
Your ear wasn't like up to
no,
me.
No. But being on both boards, I had to be, you know, kind of like not in the room, right? Because it's one of those things about, you know,
being legal.
And high integrity, yeah. Right? But it was like, look, this is how to understand this, and this is how it can come together. And so I think it's great for both companies, I think it's a pattern by which some future technology business deals will happen.
Now, you were on the board of OpenAI until a few months before the OpenAI apocalypse, whereby Sam was kicked out, and now he's back, yeah. And you were the first person.
Yeah. Six months.
6 months, okay. You're the first person I reached out to. You didn't tell me very much at the time. But now that you're here and on stage and under the bright lights, I just want to know if you can tell us a little more. Like, do we actually know what happened there? And is it fully over? Or is there something still festering beneath the surface?
Well, I have strong confidence in this current board. I think Brett Taylor is great. I think Larry Summers is great. Some of the other folks, Sue Desmond-Hellman's great. I know these people. I think that the notion here, I can say something that's almost like public fact about it, which is Mira Murati, who they appointed as the first interim CEO, was at an event with me in Napa called The Grove Thursday night. So you know they didn't call her before that dinner Thursday night, announcing on Friday that she's the interim CEO. So when you get to kind of like, okay, look, whatever you think is going on, if you're replacing the CEO with a new interim CEO, you usually don't call that person like after dinner the night before and say, oh, by the way, we're doing this blog post tomorrow. You're the CEO tomorrow. You know, maybe you should get back into town to come do that. Right? So the previous board had some competence navigation issues.
And I mean, Sam is back. Your confidence, yes. Your level of confidence?
Very high. Look, I think Sam has done an amazing job. Not perfect. No one's perfect. I'm not perfect.
Mm-hmm. Right? Are you sure?
Yes. Well, Reid AI might be perfect, not me. But like Sam and the rest of the team at OpenAI have created magic. Like this whole revolution, this whole like, oh my gosh, generative AI can be an assistant to anything that we do with language and many other things. That comes about from their work. That's just like that. That is one of the moments of this is a time to be alive. That is incredible. It is magical. And like kudos to them for doing this.
Mm-hmm. All right, last question. We have one poll to get to here, which is how worried are you about AI's role in the upcoming election? Concerned, somewhat concerned, not at all concerned. You are super active in politics, actually on both sides of the aisle in this latest election. What do you think the October surprise is going to be? And it doesn't have to have anything to do with tech. Oh, everyone's also very worried about AI in the election.
Yes, I would say very concerned. Look, I'd say what it is you'll see something like something coming out of a legal court of law and by jurors who have convicted Trump, like they convicted him of lying about and slandering about sexual assault. You'll see something else coming out about that, and then it'll be claimed that that's a deep fake, right? So it creates a language of non-truth, which is a massive problem, even when you see, like there will be some deep fake and other kinds of issues, but true things will be called deep fakes. That's the thing that I think, well, because it's really important to know, like, no, when it actually goes through a court of law and there's 12 jurors who deliberate on it and conclude, that's a real thing. Mm.
You are like a perennial optimist. How worried are you about the election? Or do we get the perennial optimist?
Look, I'm deeply concerned, but I think that people who care about kind of a future by which America is in the rule of law, that we care about your everyday American. I think if that persists, Joe Biden will be president again.
All right. The real Reid Hoffman, everybody. That was awesome. Thank you.